My brave lad, he sleeps in his faded coat of blue. In a lonely grave alone lies the heart that beats so true. They will find him and know him amongst the good and true, when a robe of white is given for that faded coat of blue. No more the blue.
Welcome to War of the Rebellion, Stories of the Civil War. I am your host, Leon Meowser, and this is a reading of the regimental history Under the Maltese Cross, Antietam to Appomattox, the Loyal Uprising in Western Pennsylvania. 1861 to 1865, Campaign's 155th Pennsylvania Regiment, narrated by the rank and file. And this is Episode 21, Chapter 10, Retreat of the Confederate Army. We're going to pick up right where we were left off. Union Army returns to old camps. Reenlistments set in. As so many of the 3 years' troops' terms were then expiring, and the government was anxious to secure their reenlistment, a disaster at Mine Run and probable repetition of Fredericksburg would have so discouraged reenlistments that would have been a most serious detriment to the country. As it was, the army returned jubilant to its camp because no battle had been fought, and the next 4 months, hostilities being suspended by both armies, was spent in winter quarters most enjoyably, and reenlistments for another 3 years of the men, whose terms were expiring, became very popular, and benefited the government enormously in securing the continuance of trained soldiers in the field. The Mine Run campaign will be memorable to all the participants because of the thousands of Union soldiers in the woods, where their guns were stacked, who might be seen because of the extraordinary cold and absence of fire, chasing each other around the trees, keeping up the action all day to keep themselves warm and their blood from freezing. Notwithstanding this, there was very great suffering and some loss of life from exposure. An exciting incident. On the march to Mine Run, an incident occurred out of the ordinary which shows the boldness of the enemy. With Meade's army of 80 or 90,000 men on the march for Mine Run, were there immense wagon trains occupying many miles in length, sandwiched between each infantry division column, conveying ammunition and rations, each army corps occupying perhaps 10 miles of the line of marching. The division and corps wagon trains were guarded by a regiment at the head and one at the end of each mile of trains. In addition to these front and rear guards for each mile of trains, individual and pioneer guards accompanied the wagons as protection, the teamsters also being well armed. In passing, on the march beyond Culpeper, on the way to Mine Run, this immense column of cavalry and infantry, batteries, ammunition, and commissary wagons, subdivided into sections and guarded as described, was attacked by a regiment of Confederate cavalry, which had lain in ambush, waiting for a weak spot in the lines of train guards. The enemy dashed out in force and succeeded in surprising and capturing the Federal train guards, pioneers, teamsters, and a dozen or more loaded army wagons, all belonging to Ayres' division, in which the 155th was serving. Among the wagons captured were several containing General Ayres' dress uniform and sword, as well as ample supplies of commissary for the general and his staff. Before the Union troops, marching in the front and the rear of this train with infantry supports, could be rallied to the rescue, the Confederate raiders succeeded in escaping with all their plunder, taking the teamsters, wagon guards, and also a number of Union soldiers, prisoners. General Ayres, being at the time in command of a division of United States regulars, received little sympathy from the volunteers, whom the regulars were forever charging with carelessness and want of military sagacity. Reynolds Fox of Company H, a faithful private of the 155th, was captured in this Confederate cavalry ambuscade of Ayres' wagon trains on the march to Mine Run, and died at Andersonville, August 23rd, 1864, being buried in grave 6,649. After enduring the miseries of the night march in zero weather on the return from Mine Run, the 155th and other troops were allowed to light fires in the morning. The severity of the frost and the miseries of the night march in the freezing weather bore a wonderful resemblance in the minds of many at the time to the description of Napoleon's historic winter retreat from Moscow. Though neither Cossacks nor Confederates harassed or in any way disturbed the slow retreat of General Meade's army. At Brandy Station, the army reached the very familiar Orange and Alexandria Railroad, where the 155th crossed the Rappahannock. This crossing, by actual count, made the 14th time that the regiment, during 1863, in its campaigns back and forward in that section of Virginia, had crossed and recrossed that historic stream. The supply of 8 days' rations, with which the troops had been supplied on the reconnaissance to Mine Run, became exhausted before the expiration of that period, and the miseries and discomforts of the severe winter weather were aggravated by the agonies of hunger affecting most of the troops before they reached camp, or met the long-looked-for commissary, and again had their empty haversacks refilled. After a 2-mile march from the Rappahannock along the Orange and Alexandria Railroad on December 3, 1863, the regiment and the accompanying brigades halted, and a most welcome distribution of rations took place. The next morning, the march along the Orange and Alexandria Railroad towards Washington was resumed, passing Bealeton Station and halting at Warrington Junction, the place destined to be the winter quarters of the regiment for some months following. Winter quarters at Warrington Junction. The 5th Corps was detailed all along this railroad to guard and protect it from the raids of Mosby's guerrillas. Warrington Junction and vicinity was assigned to the care and observation of General Garrard's brigade of Ayres' division, with which the 155th was serving. Orders were given on December 5th to lay out the regimental camp and to locate headquarters of the regiment. This involved the going of the men of each mess to the near woods to cut, split, and carry in timber necessary for the log huts of which winter quarters were to be formed. The camp was laid out in regular streets, the company officers' quarters being at the head of the streets, with non-commissioned officers next, followed by that of the privates. The architecture of these structures, although primitive, was uniform in style, being limited to space sufficient for 3 men occupying a joint bunk, and having a fireplace of old-fashioned style, and a chimney, which frequently failed to carry upward all the smoke. No fenders, tongs, or mantelpieces graced the fittings of the fireplace. The interior was free from anything like cupboards or boxes. The canteens were hung upon the floor. The cooking utensils were very limited in number and primitive in style. The same tin bucket in which the meals and coffee were cooked, with scant rinsing from the limited supply of water, being made to do duty in cooking soups, boiling beans or dried apples, making rice puddings, stewing elderberries, and many other purposes. The only art decorations on the walls of the quarters consisted of cuts from Harper's and Leslie's, war pictures illustrating desperate cavalry charges and infantry engagements. The uncarpeted floors were composed of split timbers. The fires were made of sticks and logs of wood, the cordage of the same being under the bed to prevent being appropriated by mistake. The pitched roof of the huts were made of canvas tents furnished by the government, sometimes to keep the light from shining through the transparent white canvas after the tattoo had sounded, lights out. The occupants, desiring to continue games of euchre or peniente after hours, would throw heavy blankets over the roof to shut off the light from the officer of the day, charged with the enforcement of camp orders after tattoo had been sounded. The actual work of making these quarters fell very hard upon the city-bred boys, and the companies because of their total non-familiarity with the use of hatchets, axes or picks, or the tools necessary to build the quarters. But the tie of comradeship was so strong that the woodsmen from the country companies, familiar with this sort of labor, cheerfully aided the inexperienced town boy soldiers in the construction of their quarters. The streets of the camp were wide and commodious and policed regularly by the removal of all garbage. The chimneys on these structures or huts in the camp were unique features. A beer keg or cracker box, or any other kind of keg or box possible to obtain, was considered a proper crowning article for the chimney surmounting the fireplace of the soldier's hut. When these could not be obtained, hardtack boxes were sometimes strengthened and used for the same purpose, and both forms of chimneys served their purpose very well. Although it must be admitted that all the smoke created in the soldiers' quarters did not go up the chimney. Life in winter quarters, amusements, etc. Strong temptations were offered, as in Camp Humphreys of the previous year, and in fact, were often yielded to on many occasions in this winter camp by mischievous comrades, to play jokes upon the inmates through the use of these chimneys. Long after tattoo and the occupants of the quarters had retired, the fire in the primitive fireplace being well slacked so as to keep the interior warm, the midnight guard called to leave camp for duty before going to his distant post, would place a plank or a board on top of the chimney, thus soon driving all the smoke inside. The mischievous guard, in the meantime, having proceeded to his post of duty out of camp limits, would be beyond suspicion, or, in case of being accused, would have a good alibi. When the irate inmates, nearly suffocated, would rush out of their huts and denounce the villainous deed, and the orderly sergeant or some other officer would be aroused to hunt for the invisible demon who, of course, could not be found. This form of disturbing the sleeping inmates was varied by the outgoing midnight guards occasionally taking from his 60 rounds of ammunition a handful or two of cartridges, which, putting in a paper and tying with a string, he would lower down through the chimney to the slacked fire, when in a short time an explosion would follow from the discharge of the cartridges. During the excitement sure to succeed the explosion, the mischievous guard would escape to his post of duty, some distance beyond the camp limits, and of course, all trace of the offender would be lost. From this camp, Colonel Kenner Garrard, of the 146th New York Volunteers, who, as senior colonel, on the 2nd of July, had succeeded to the command of the brigade, took his departure as brigade commander, having been promoted to a brigadier generalship and assigned to the command of a division of cavalry in the Western Army, where he later earned great distinction with General Sherman. The 155th Regiment, in particular, owed General Garrard a debt of gratitude for the personal interest manifested by him in the welfare of the regiment, and enabling it to earn the high distinction it subsequently gained under Colonel Alfred L. Pearson. Colonel E. M. Gregory, commanding 91st Pennsylvania Volunteers, succeeds General Garrard. General Garrard, as commander of the brigade, was succeeded by Colonel Edward M. Gregory of the 91st Pennsylvania Volunteers, a popular and brave officer. Colonel Gregory subsequently became equally noted in the Army for his zeal as a Christian worker, often varying the duties of military life by preaching and conducting prayer meeting services at his own brigade headquarters, and also at company and regimental meetings of the 155th. The 91st Pennsylvania, Colonel Gregory's own regiment, which had been recruited in the famous Moemensing district of Philadelphia, afforded a fine field for Christian missionary work for Colonel Gregory. The men composing the regiment, although being splendid fighters, were far from being angels or piously inclined. In this camp, Colonel Gregory started a religious revival in the ranks of the 155th Regiment, which lasted for several weeks and won a great many converts to experience religion. It is but proper to credit Companies K and G of the regiment with these pious awakenings and converts. that extremes would meet on the subject of religious enthusiasm, even in the same companies, is made apparent on the perusal of a diary of a most worthy and exemplary Christian soldier of Company D, the late Corporal M.V.B. Salada, which was submitted to the compilers of the regimental history. In this journal, there appears the solemn record entered under date of January 21, 1864, Camp Warrington Junction. Quote, "The company was paid off today and went on a general drunk." Unquote. This was followed by a second entry on the same date. Quote, 8 p.m. held prayer meeting services conducted by Peter Tippin. Unquote. Early in December, while in these winter quarters, the regiment was called upon to witness on very short notice the execution of a private soldier of the 11th United States Regular Infantry, convicted of desertion. Like the former executions previously described, General Sykes' entire division was drawn up in the three sides of a square to witness the sad ceremony. It was an affecting scene, and happily, the last to be witnessed by the 155th during the remainder of its term of service. On December 26th, Companies E and K packed up and relieved part of the 91st Pennsylvania on guard duty at Catlett Station on the Orange and Alexandria Railroad. These companies went into the quarters of the 91st Pennsylvania, which had been moved out that day, but the enjoyment of these fine winter huts by Company G and K was of short duration, as within 24 hours they were sent to Bristow Station, and at the end of 3 weeks were marched back to the regimental camp at Warrington Junction. Orders allowing 10-day furloughs issued. In this camp, while the army was resting, General Meade, to add to the good feeling prevalent in the camps of his army and to encourage reenlistments, which the government was most anxious to take place, issued orders that 10-day furloughs would be granted to worthy soldiers of each regiment, the only condition being that some good reason must be assigned in order to obtain the furlough, and that only 7 applicants should be absent from the regiment on furlough at any one time. As the precise reasons on which furloughs were to be granted were not specified, but were left to the discretion of the applicant, the greatest variety of declarations as to the urgency and necessity of the furloughs was embodied in the petitions in order to ensure the success of their request. The formality required in the application for a furlough was a respectful letter from the soldier to the colonel of his regiment, who in turn, if the application was approved, forwarded it to brigade headquarters with his endorsement. If the application was not approved by the colonel, it went into the wastebasket. At brigade headquarters, the application for a furlough went through the same process of treatment, and if approved, was sent to division headquarters by the brigade commander with his endorsement. Undergoing the same mode of treatment at division headquarters by the division commander, the application was finally forwarded to corps headquarters. If, during its journey from the regimental headquarters to corps headquarters, the reasons assigned for wanting a furlough were disapproved by the intermediate commanders, it found its way to the wastebasket. As a corps was composed of 3 divisions, each having 12 regiments and a number of batteries, the corps commander received for consideration over 100 applications a day. At first, Major General Sykes, commanding the 5th Corps, undertook to read and pass upon the urgent reasons assigned, but the perusal of applications containing so many manifestly distressing cases of death, suffering, and misery, necessitating the presence of the applicants at home, soon wearied General Sykes. After some weeks of this experience in reading the recitals in these applications, many of which he could not avoid suspecting as being fictitious, the general assigned the 100 or more daily petitions received to the adjutant general of the corps. In turn, this official struggled with the perusal of the harrowing reasons assigned for immediate furloughs and wrestled with the puzzling problems presented. After some weeks of this trying exercise, the adjutant general in turn got rid of this duty by turning over subsequent applications to the enlisted men who were confidential clerks at corps headquarters. These clerks enjoyed the reading of the letters, being aware in many cases of the suspicious character of many of the contents, This task of reading the fabricated excuses finally became so monotonous that, for the peace and comfort of all concerned, the confidential clerks, to avoid reading the voluminous applications, decided to draw lots for the lucky seven, and the applications thereafter were decided in that way. New Year's in Camp. New Year's Day, 1864, in this camp was made memorable to the men in the ranks by the presence of the regimental sutler, who had on hand nice plump chickens at the cost of $1 each, and fine fat turkeys at the price of $6 apiece. Apples were sold by the sutler according to their size, and eggs according to their age. But prices did not deter the well-paid officers from indulging in both chickens and turkeys. There were very few messes of privates who could afford the luxury of paying the prices demanded for the poultry. Uncle Sam, however, voluntarily distributed gratuitously old rye whiskey, styled commissary, to the men in honor of the day, in the proportion of 1 quart to 12 men. No excesses or abuse of this infinitesimal distribution of whiskey was apparent in the camp, and the best of feeling prevailed. The usual thoughts and reminiscence of the year just ended impressed the soldier, and thoughts of home and friends, as well as anticipations of what the future might have in store for the nation and for the individual in the army, also occasioned more than a passing thought. The day was also made memorable by the extremely cold weather, so intense as to prevent sleep. It was too cold even to sit before the fire. The boys on picket suffered very severely from this night's exposure. January 3rd was the first Sunday of the new year in this camp, and Chaplain Mater preached a sermon in the chapel, but the weather was so bitterly cold that the sermon had to be cut short and audience dismissed without the doxology. Colonel John H. Kane resigns. In this camp, Colonel John H. Kane resigned the colonelcy to resume business in Pittsburgh, left in the hands of his partners on his entering the military service. Colonel Kane had risen from rank of private in the 12th Regiment Pennsylvania Volunteers in 3 months' service to the colonelcy of the 155th Regiment. He commanded the regiment at Chancellorsville and elicited in official reports high commendations from both General Humphreys, commanding the division, as well as from General Meade, in command of the 5th Corps. He was also in command of the regiment in the Battle of Gettysburg, where, on Little Round Top, he with the regiment earned great distinction. No more gentlemanly or popular commander ever served with the regiment. Both officers and men were assembled to receive his cordial handshake, a farewell parting to the gallant officer. Colonel A.L. Pearson assumes command. Alfred L. Pearson, Lieutenant Colonel, was in Washington City when Colonel Kane's resignation was accepted, and he was at once commissioned colonel and arrived in camp and assumed command. Colonel Pearson inaugurated more frequent drilling and soon imparted enthusiasm and ambition to officers and men to win distinction for proficiency of drill and excellency of discipline. The promotion of Major John Ewing to rank of Lieutenant Colonel and of Captain John H. Klein to Major soon followed and gave great satisfaction as deserved recognition to worthy officers. All right, we'll go ahead and we'll finish the rest of this chapter next week. Man, there's really nothing like not fighting a battle to get reenlistments up, huh? I can just imagine just being in camp for months is pretty nice. Even though you count down every day to your enlistment, I've read so many accounts of soldiers who did that. It's just nice to know that they did it too, wasn't just me. They often saying things like, why did I sign up for this? I know that feeling. There's one account that I found It was from a soldier who was like, he signed up because someone gave him a piece of cheese to deliver. For the entire time that he was in the Union Army, he was just like, I cursed that cheese over and over and over again. Like, I know the feeling, man. I know the feeling. So the Union Army getting reenlistments, like, that's a real problem. Because a lot of dudes, like, being in the military just sucks a lot of the time. So I can understand the importance of what they're trying to do. Let's move on to the Mine Run campaign. I think civilians probably miss this part often. Just because no battle is fought doesn't mean that men don't die or get messed up forever, have issues and problems. I can think of a half dozen people I know who suffered similar fates to those during the Mine Run campaign, suffering from exposure, and those were just training operations for me. I can't imagine what it's like during combat operations when it comes to amassing 10,000 men and just not doing anything. Like, that's crazy. That's not something you'll ever see in the modern military. All right. The ambush that they happened, that they talked about, where one of the soldiers from the 155th died at Andersonville. Private Reynolds Fox. I drink to you, sir, and your grave of 6,649. I will include a link on my website to a film on YouTube that is totally uploaded legally for the Andersonville film. Someone was gracious enough to put it up for us on parts one and part two. It is actually quite good. I do recommend watching it. And it also shows you, like, the absolutely deplorable, horrible conditions that those men had to live in at Andersonville. Moving on to slightly better topics. I really enjoy them setting themselves up for winter quarters. If someone had a whole novel or a whole regimental history and it was just all about them in winter quarters, I would really enjoy that. Especially since the fact that they continued to pull pranks on each other. Especially the same pranks from the year before. Man, pranks are like the thing to do for people when you're in the military and you're bored out of your mind. Like, just let me paint the story for you. You're about to go out in the freezing snow or the rain or the sleet, or maybe it's just cold. It's the middle of the night, and one of your best friends is in a tent or a structure nearby. All you gotta do is take a thin piece of wood, put it over his chimney, so you can mess with him, ruin his whole night. Wouldn't you do it? I would. I would at least do that. I would not be brave enough to put the cartridges down into the chimney. That must be awful. I think at some point I'm going to do that. I'm going to take two full cartridges, lower them down over a fire in a mock chimney and record it exploding just to see what it's like. Because, I mean, it's going to be loud, but should I fall asleep and then have someone do it to me? No, that'd be messed up. Maybe later. I don't know. We'll figure it out. But I'm going to do that at some point. Oh, there goes my ice machine making some ice again. But I would definitely be, if I was in camp, I'd be way too chicken to lower down powder into a fireplace. Let me know what you would do. Would you do it? I don't think I would. I'd cover up a chimney, but I don't think I would. I would lower powder into a fireplace. Soldiers getting paid and going on a general drunk. I never seen that before. Honest, I've never, ever, ever seen infantrymen get drunk. We certainly don't change, do we? I wonder if it would be the same. But I know for me, as soon as we were off work, dudes would just be in the barracks, like, knocking back 36 packs every night. So I can't imagine how hard you would go if you only got to drink when you got paid, or every couple of weeks, or every couple months. We would do that on deployment, only drink when you got back, and you would, you know, you'd be sober for 6 months at a time. But then when you were back in the fleet, specifically in the barracks, just dudes would drink all the time. I would drink all the time, too. It took me a long time to figure out what normal drinking was because of the Marine Corps. Oh, gosh. In regards to the applications to go on leave, let's talk about that. I could see where that was going long before it was going to get thrown in the wastebasket. If anyone has worked in any headquarters capacity whatsoever, and I briefly got to do it for about 4 months, we would call that, in modern terms, the big green weenie. And it was, the big green weenie was taking care of all of those loyal American sons right then and there. Like, can you imagine? Everyone's like making things up so they can go home, and your wife is sick and you really do need to see your kids, but the guy next to you is going home instead. Oh. Luckily, they're really good about that now. And if you need to go home, they can help you get home. But oh, back then, when it was just, you just had to write a letter. Oh boy. And the fact that the letters were just handed down to somebody on the food chain because somebody's just too important to deal with it, until it was just letters of enlisted letters going to enlisted men to read. And then the enlisted men were like, nah, we'll just draw straws. It's just like, yeah, that's about right. That sounds about right. That's how it works in the military. Also, getting some booze as a treat. It's pretty nice. I wish I got something like that. Never happened. They're always trying to take our booze away. So having the government give booze to people, that's nice. I approve. But one quart per 12 men? Oh, that's rough. That's rough, boys. It's been all these years later, and I can feel your pain for you through the passages of time. But that, my friends, I'm going to go ahead and wrap it up. I've got a lot to do. I guess I will update you a little bit about the happenings and goings and all of the other stuff that I'm doing. I am marching to Gettysburg. I'm going to do that. I have a step-off point. It's going to be in Maryland, Frederick, Maryland. And I'm going to follow the 5th Corps route for about 65 miles. That's going to be towards the end of June, which, my goodness, is not that far away at all. So I'm getting very prepared for that. This next week is my spring break for my job. So I'm heading out to a trail where I'm going to do 30 miles in 3 days. But I'm going to see how it feels. And if I think I can do the extra 5 miles both days, then I will. But doing 15 miles in 2 days would be really nice. Not the fact that I'm going to be like, 15 miles is pretty standard for hiking these days. These guys were doing, you know, for reminding ourselves about it. These boys were doing 25 miles or 20 miles every day, day after day after day. And I'm only going to do half of what they were doing. So, but I am going to GoPro it. Stop along the way at various points and check things out and look at things. But mostly, I want to look at the terrain. And it's one thing to look at the terrain as a soldier or someone military-minded who's driving. But I really want to look at it from someone who's walking, who's carrying all of that stuff. Specifically being very tired and pushing through those extra 10 miles or those extra 15 miles. Just to get to Gettysburg, and what it looks like when you're on your way there. So that when I go back and I read what the 155th was doing, coming up through certain areas, going up to Little Round Top, I have the same feeling that they did. The same tiredness. So, it's going to be very interesting, indeed. But I will keep you guys updated. I'll probably post some extra pictures coming this week, since I'm going to have the time. I won't be working. I'll post pictures of my gear and things about like who got it for me. I should do some shout outs for some of the stuff that I bought from people. And also, you know, I've put a lot of miles on a lot of this gear already, and it's held up pretty well. So a little bit, there's a few things here and there. I had to get my own stuff to repair some stuff already, but nothing too crazy. But then again, I am putting it through its paces, and a lot of this gear is probably stuff that they expect modern reenactors to do, to like only use it for a weekend, maybe put 10 miles on it over the course of, maybe, let's be generous, even like 50 miles over the course of a year. I'm going to put that much on it in one go for this hike, and then some. But I'm going to put maybe two or three times that, maybe even four times that before I even get there. Like, that's my goal. So all my free time is like, can I put in 10 miles today? Can I put in 15 miles today? Because that's the only way to prepare for something like this. So I've been really working on it, guys. I'm telling you, it's rough stuff. But it has been a real joy to do. And it's been really great when I'm like carrying all of the stuff, rifle included, 1861 Springfield. And I'm like hiking to see people's reaction just to me like coming around the corner. It's been great. Oh my goodness. Oh, I'm crazy. All right. Folks, have a great one. I'll see you next week. Have a great weekend. And if you have spring break off like me, enjoy it.
No more the bugle calls the weary one. Rest, noble spirit, in thy grave alone. They will find you and know you amongst the good and true. When a robe of white is given for that faded coat of blue, he cried, give me water and just one little crumb, and my mother, she will bless you through all the years to come. Go tell my sweet sister, so gentle, good and true, that I'll meet her up in heaven in my faded coat of blue. No more the bugle calls the weary one. Rest, noble spirit, in thy grave alone. They will find you and know you amongst the good and true. When a robe of white is given for that faded coat of blue.